Good morning. Welcome to the fifth session of our seminar series, CPS Talks with Authors, co-organized by the Research Committee on Political Sociology and the Faculty of Education and Social Sciences at Andres Bello University. This seminar is sponsored by the International Sociological Association and the International Political Science Association, by the Vice Rectory for Research of Andres Bello University, and the Global Network of Women Political Scientists. In this session, Laurence Morel, who is professor of the University of Lille and Sciences Po Paris, and also co-chair of our research committee, will present her book, The Question of Referendum, La Question du Referendum, published by Les Presses de Sciences Po. Laurence Morel is a specialist of direct democracy, more specifically in this book, the history of referendum, with a focus on French politics. She has also published on the French Fifth Republic, on types of leadership, quality of democracy, the left in Europe, among other subjects. The presentation will be followed or immediately followed by a 15-minute comments by Yanis Papadopoulos, professor at the Institute of Political Studies, University of Lausanne, whose research focuses on the various implications of governance transformations for democracy and accountability, and who has published a lot on governance and direct democracy. His most recent books include Democracy in Crisis, Politics, Governance and Policy, among many others. Thanks a lot, Yanis, for accepting our invitation. Just a reminder, you can use the chat box to leave your questions that will be answered by our presenter after Yanis' comments. Laurence and Yanis, I leave you the floor.
Okay, so I guess I should start with my presentation. So first of all, I want to thank you, Stephanie, for your invitation. Despite the fact that the book is in French and is a lot about France, also not only, but I mean, you insisted, I must say, that it was worth. So I agreed, and I hope those who listen won't be, let's say, discouraged to look at the book. And thank you very much, Yanis, because you are the specialist of direct democracy, more than myself, if I am allowed to say that, as the Greek and Swiss together. So as a French, I don't feel very much authorized, but I mean, to speak about direct democracy, at least true direct democracy, well, that's actually an important distinction, what is really direct democracy. So in fact, this book, I just want to show it a little, you, I don't know if you can see it, you know, well, probably you see it with not in the right direction, but I published it 1 year ago, and it's a book, thank you, Stephanie, it's a book,
it doesn't work,
but I said in French, but which is also in part about France. Actually, it's a small book, but it's also quite ambitious, I must confess, because it has a sort of double ambition. On one side, it tries to be comparative and general. So it's about definition of what the referendum is, about provisions and practice of referendum in democracies, and especially in Europe. It's about the history of referendum, especially in the, let's say, nutshell of three countries, the United States, Switzerland, and France in the 19th century. But it's also, there is also a chapter 7 on direct democracy in democratic theory, how it is viewed. And there are also two chapters on the, let's say, the state of knowledge on referendum effects. So, but this is one part of the book, which is about 6 chapters, but there are also 3 chapters on France, because I have actually mostly published comparative works in English in my career, so I felt I was sort of obliged to publish something on France in French. And so there are 3 chapters, the Swiss central chapter and the conclusion, and history of the referendum in France. It's a very specific history. It started in the revolution, the French Revolution. And actually, the French Revolution was a sort of parenthesis. Now, with distance, we can say it was a more parenthesis insofar as the referendums, they were not called referendums, but they were votes, were on constitutions, and they were sort of obligatory referendums. But then, with the Bonapartist regime, we started in France a largely top-down referendum story, either on undemocratic conditions under the Bonapartist regimes, as I was just saying, or under democratic conditions, namely under the Fifth Republic, starting with De Gaulle, but also the successive president who by law were the initiators of the referendum. And so we have a very specific story, which is top-down, as I said, but which is also about the personalization of the referendum, because it's very difficult in such a system that the referendum is not about the person who initiated. It's as he or she, it was always so he, is so important, that is the president of the republic. So the referendum in France has this sort of problems, let's say, and in fact it has a bad reputation because it tends to transform in a confidence vote, in a trust or distrust vote, thus it doesn't answer the question which is formally asked. And but it has also a bad reputation for less, let's say, official reasons. It's just because it didn't produce the result that was expected the last time. So it's a sort of dormant institution now, presently, the presidential referendum. Then we have introduced in the French Constitution a minority referendum 10 years ago. That is a referendum which can be triggered by both a parliamentary minority and a popular minority, but it is its implementation is very difficult, and actually we never had an experience of such a minority referendum, which was supposed to put an end to a tradition of top-down plebiscitary referendums. So the book is also, the center part of the book is about France. So if you are interested with the French story of referendum, you should like, I mean, be interested with that part of the book. And the conclusion of the book is actually a list, I mean, a sort of a proposal of, about how we could reform the referendum in France in the future. But for this presentation, I thought my focus should be on the comparative part of the book. I agreed that with Yanis, at least I informed him. And so actually I will focus very much on chapter 2 of the book, where in which I present the data that I have collected, mostly actually from my previous book on referendum, which was edited with Matt Quertrup. Namely the Routledge Handbook of to Referendum and Direct Democracy. So for this book, I collected a lot of data about provision for referendums in the countries of the world and also the practice. And I want to show you a little bit this, although in the book we are talking about, I have restricted this data to European democracies, while in the Routledge Handbook, it's an effort to include all the 195 independent states of the world. So what is basic in that, in my findings, is that there is a clear increase of both the institutionalization of referendum mechanism and its practice in the world. So, then, and in the last, in my conclusion, I will tackle another question, which is, let's say, the future of the referendum, particularly, especially in relation to his, let's say, statute in democratic theory today. So, first, the growing institutionalization and practice of the referendum. First, the institutionalization, that means, what is the state of provisions for referendum in the in the independent states, in the states in the world. So what I found in my data is that as for 2016, 80% of the 195 independent states in the world have provision for a national referendum, or so it's a very high proportion. But it must be added, the popular initiative, which is probably the most democratic form of referendum, is present only in 25% of this country, of this country. So there is a difference in this aspect. Then the second thing I observed is that the so-called third wave of democratization, which an intense moment was after the 89, after the Berlin Wall fall, has also been a wave of direct democratization, in the sense that many countries have introduced referendum mechanism in this in their constitution in the last 30 years, and this is particularly true of post-communist European democracies, which very interestingly have introduced a lot the popular initiative and the obligatory referendum and the obligatory referendum. So today, if we look only at the 32 European democracies that I have included in my book, half of these countries, exactly half, 16 out of 30, have a minority referendum at national level on a large area of questions. So it's important. And I'm talking of a minority referendum. For 12 countries, it's a popular initiative. For 4 countries, it's a parliamentary minority initiative. So I want to show you, I've done a table which shows that, but I don't know. Well, unfortunately, it is in French. You can imagine this. Trying to show you. Yes, that's my the first table. So you see, I have this table is about institutionalization of the referendum in European democracy, and I have identified 5 referendum profile. And in fact, profile 1 and 2 are all the country, which are 16. You have the countries in the right column. As all the countries which have a minority referendum. That means a referendum which can be triggered by a minority, in most cases popular, in some cases parliamentary. So it's a lot. And you will see that most of these countries are East Europe countries, plus, of course, Switzerland, which is a well-known case. But what is also important to say is that among these countries which have a popular initiative of a minority referendum, many of these countries, especially in the East, have, let's say, detailed restriction to the use of referendum. What it means? It means that you cannot look only at the initiator and the range of issues. You also have to look at more in detail to the number of signatures, to the deadlines to collect signatures, to the quorum, party turnout quorums or approval quorums. And if you look at this, and that's what I have in these tables, you see signature quorums, then clearly it appears that most European, East European democracies have strong restriction actually to these popular initiatives. And in fact, either they can't trigger the referendum, popular initiative cannot make it to be actually organized, or the result is invalidated because the quorum is not reached. So the only country which really has very few restriction is Switzerland. But this is Anyway, it's not to say that popular initiative is not is irrelevant in East European countries, but it is not as important as it could seem at first sight. And but there are countries like Slovenia or Hungary, where it works quite a lot. Then there is also a rise of the practice of the referendum. And you see my data concerning all the countries in the world, not only Europe. It is clearly, it's clear. And in green is all the countries except Switzerland. Purple, it is Switzerland. It's specialists of direct democracy are used to the fact of putting Switzerland aside because it distorts the number as it has a completely untypical practice of the referendum, very, very intense, as you know. So that's for the rise of the practice. Then here I have a table in Europe, in the 32 European democracies. You can see the evolution for each country. The evolution is the number of referendum held for each country, each decade. And here I have put some, I have made profiles, but this time regarding the practice of the referendum, and I found various profiles. What is interesting is that we have, you see that we have the four profile, intense users, very frequent users, frequent user, regular user. We have 12 countries out of 32, so it's quite a lot, it's almost half. Then we have 11 countries where it's sporadic use. And between brackets, you have the number of referendum in the period, which is from 1990 to 2019. And only then we have about nine exceptional user or non-user. So that's give an impression. Then I have here I have a table. It's really about details, but if you're interested in the type of referendum which has been practiced in each of the 32 European democracy, you can have it. And now I have also done made another type of profile. It's the dominant type of referendum practice in the various European democracies. And here again, I have five profile. Again, it confirms the importance of bottom-up and obligatory referendum, which are the two types, let's say, which are more authentically direct democracy, because a domination of the popular initiative in the practice, either a mixed model with about half-half popular initiative and government-initiated referendum, and then countries with the obligatory referendum. So all this makes 14 countries. Then you have another big group of countries which mainly have government-initiated referendum. And of course, they have also had much less referendums than the 14 countries which have popular initiative and obligatory referendum. So that's the profile I found. Now, I want to say two words about the explanation that can be given of this increase in institutionalization and use of the referendum in the world, but particularly in Europe. And there are two types of theory about the causes of this rise of the referendum. I would call them micro theories and macro theories. Micro theories are about, let's say, actors' decision. Macro theories are about, let's say, predictive contextual factors. So micro theories can themselves be divided in three types. There are two traditional theories which are, let's say, rational theories, which explain the use of referendum by strategic calculation of actors and especially political actors, and diffusion theory, which are more about imitation, institution spreading. In fact, the rational explanation has more to do with the organization of specific referendum, while the diffusion theory has more to do with introduction of direct democracy mechanisms, so institutionalization of referendum. But it's interesting to see that there are also rational theory explanation for the introduction of mechanism in constitution. For example, an example is in Switzerland, the introduction of the veto referendum at the end of the 19th century can to a great extent be explained by a calculation of the small opposition parties who wanted to have a device, a weapon, let's say, to influence and to counterbalance the domination of the radical party. And the same in Italy, the implementation of the abrogative referendum in the beginning of the 70s had much to do with the, tactics of the Christian Democrats, who wanted to give the conservative minorities a weapon to eventually defeat in a referendum the new legislation introducing divorce. So each type of explanation is not completely limited to either to the holding of specific referendum or the introduction of mechanism, but each one has, let's say, sort of has a predilection, let's say, for something in particular. The macro theories, well, there is also another, let's say, micro theories, which is more, I would say, of neo-institutionalists, which tend to explain either specific referendum or the introduction of direct democracy mechanism in terms of appropriateness. And if you want, I will develop this later. Then macro theories. Macro theories actually are more sort of research field which could be investigated and which is sometimes suggested, as in my book. Macro theories are more interested in historical and institutional factors. And here I think that's what I explained in my book. There can be two main hypotheses regarding Europe in particular. First, the first hypothesis is about the existence of two Europes with two different stories. Western Europe's, where most countries actually have a practice of referendums dominated by top-down referendums or no practice at all. And on the other side, post-communist Europe, where many countries have popular initiative or obligatory referendums. So they have one has to look a little bit in the history and the specific condition of democracy in these countries. The second hypothesis.
Laurence, yes? could you stop sharing your screen? Could you stop sharing your screen?
Oh, I thought I had done this. I can't. I see you. I don't see my tables. My tables. You see the tables?
Constanza sent me a message and she said that I had to. It's much better
now.
It's okay.
Yeah, it's okay now. It's okay.
So I was saying the second hypothesis in the range of macro theories could be based on the correlation between the user profile in terms of dominant kind of referendum used in the various countries and the two tripart model of democracies. And what I found in my book, what I explained, is that it is striking that the six pure majoritarian democracies in Europe all belong to the top-down referendum profiles, while countries which have popular initiative or obligatory referendum profiles are all consensual countries in LIPAC terms. So that's how things could be, let's say, sketched out for research. So in conclusion, I just want to say that direct democracy is on the rise, but the question is it an irresistible rise? It's not sure at all. There are still many obstacles to its institutionalization and practice. Political elites out, except Switzerland, probably are still very reluctant to the referendum. And moreover, and that's the topic I tackle in my chapter 7 of the book, academic elites are also very reluctant to direct democracy mechanism, and especially academic elites who are not expected to be reluctant, that is democratic theorists who think about new ways to answer the current crisis of representative democracy. And even among those of these democratic theorists who believe this has to be done through a deepening of democracy and a major involvement of the ordinary citizen, often the referendum or direct democracy mechanism are rejected as if there would not be the, normal, natural way to increase the influence of the ordinary citizen. And here, I think if I have tried to identify the three main kind of what I call ordinary citizen theory of democratic innovation, that is mini public theories, digital democrats, the digital democracy theories, and liquid delegated democracy. And I can, if you're interested, I can show you that almost systematically in these three bodies of literature, everything is invented to involve the ordinary citizen, which is not direct democracy. But, and this is the conclusion of my conclusion, there is also a new generation of works, especially young researchers in democratic theory, who have started very recently to highlight the limit of ordinary citizen theories, which do not want to research to direct democracy, and to show that the referendum and the popular initiative with some correctives we are here in the realm of institutional design, can really be a way to correctly increase citizen influence in politics for the good of democracy. And I think one can even I will stop here because I've been a bit long, so I can develop further all this in the discussion. Thank you for your attention.
Yeah. Thank you, Laurence. Thank you, Laurence, for this presentation. We will now listen to Yanis' comments.
Yes. Hello, everybody. Thanks very much. Thanks very much for this invitation to discuss Laurence's excellent book. I really want to say that it was a true pleasure to delve into your book, Laurence, and that I learned a lot from it. So what I would like to emphasize first is that Laurence must clearly be commended for her work. This is a book with an extraordinary breadth. We have seen this right now in her presentation, in her oral talk, and the typological exercise that she presented. And it's an extraordinary breadth, despite the intentional, deliberate focus on the French case in a couple of chapters. It is, I would say, really an intellectual tour de force, because it manages to combine the encompassing scrutiny of very diverse referendum mechanisms. We have just seen that in the presentation. So the scrutiny, the empirical scrutiny of these mechanisms and the fine-grained analysis of these referendums combined with strong theoretical knowledge, and the book offers absolutely perspicacious insights. Well, as you know, this book, Laurence published her book in French, but I think it really deserves to be translated in other languages to reach the broader audience that it truly deserves. So as Laurence wrote in her book and as she said in her talk, this is a period, we live in a period in which demands more generally, I would say, for popular participation are on the rise. They are sometimes captured and promoted by anti-establishment movements. Popular initiatives and referendums are an obvious avenue to challenge elite rule. Their use has been on the rise in the last decades. Whether the rise is irresistible or not, we do not know. So they have been on the rise, even though we have seen it with different modalities and for different purposes. However, at least this is my take on the debate. The debate on these institutions and these tools is often polarized, unduly polarized, mainly due to misconceptions and to the lack of accurate knowledge of referendum mechanisms, of the diverse characteristics, and consequently of the very different effects they deploy on political systems. And I think Laurence's book is the perfect guide to navigate competently in such debates. It's a systematic comparative approach, which is supplemented with deep historical knowledge, offers us a nuanced, a differentiated picture on the topic. And I would say that even the more monographic sections on French politics and history are extremely illuminating as well. Well, as you can understand, it is, as you can easily understand, that it's impossible to address all the crucial issues that can be raised by this extremely stimulating book, which is not as short as Laurence pretends. Let me just pick a few of them that I think which are present in the book, which, however, Laurence did not address, at least in depth, in her talk. I think my first point is that, well, what I found a very interesting finding from survey research that you present in your book, Laurence, is that demands for referendum also originate from working class people, from the lower educated segments of the population who feel excluded from the political game. At the same time, we know that these groups are less likely to turn out, including in referendums. So we have these demands, but we also know that participation in referendums, akin similarly to participation in elections, is subject to a selection bias, the Schatzschneider's upper class pluralist call. So my first question, Laurence, is what do you think about the democratizing potential of referendums if they do not offer a contribution in attenuating participation bias? That's my first point. The second point is about a somewhat related question, which regards the quality of deliberation in direct democratic campaigns. There is no doubt that these campaigns increase the amount of deliberation. Also, they facilitate the dissemination of information on policy issues that, as we know, can be highly complex. So the question is whether such an increase in quantity also leads to an increase in quality of deliberation as well. This is a matter of contention in the literature, and you are right to emphasize, Laurence, that even participationists tend to remain skeptical in that respect. So I would like to hear you on that question of the quality of deliberation. maybe also listen to your evaluation of the merits of existing attempts to remedy the problem. For example, but this is one model among, just a model among others, the so-called Oregon model. You refer to it very briefly in the book, even though you refer more generally to similar models. I read an interesting discussion of these kinds of models on a French policy paper of Terra Nova on the Referendum d'Initiative Citoyenne Délibérative. So, well, the Oregon model, as the name indicates, was originally developed in the state of Oregon, in the US. It has been increasingly replicated in different settings. And the aim of the model is, it has been designed for the purpose of enhancing the quality of deliberation in direct democracy. So the idea is that, you first set up a mini public. You referred to mini public theory just before. So a mini public, which is composed of randomly selected individuals to ensure that the mini public is representative. And this mini public convinced in a first step to receive information by experts on the policy issue that is subject to the vote. It then deliberates, and in a next step, the conclusions of the group deliberations, which are supposed to be well informed by expert input, are disseminated to the whole population that is called to vote. Well, it seems, at least from some initial experiments in Switzerland, that citizens do trust a lot this kind of input of information. So one might expect that it can motivate them to turn out, to vote, and in addition to formulate a sound judgment. So what is your view on the coupling between mini publics and direct democracy? Is this a suitable way to reduce most notably the risk of manipulation? Because the risk of manipulation is, as we know, one of the main criticisms that is addressed to institutions of direct democracy. My last question is about the relation to policy, to which Laurence dedicated chapter 9 in her book. I think there's no doubt that submitting policy issues to popular votes increases the acceptance of policy and thereby the legitimacy of decisions. And in that sense, Laurence is absolutely right in pointing out the win-win game that may take place between direct and representative democracy. So it is, and Laurence demonstrates this very well, it is completely wrong to oppose direct and representative democracy. But the problem is how they are coupled, but one should not oppose them. However, whether direct democracy leads to better policy or not, this is controversial. And you do an excellent job, Laurence, in providing a nuanced account of the controversies on that issue. Let me, however, make two comments on that point. First, Laurence admits that empirical evidence is inconclusive as to who benefits from the outcomes of referendums. She writes, you write, Laurence, that referendum outcomes are not favorable to sexual minorities. Well, the domain of morality issues is probably a quickly evolving one. For example, this Sunday, we are voting in Switzerland on same-sex marriage. And at least according to the polls, opinion polls tend to show that the outcome will in all likelihood be positive. On the other hand, there is work by Adrian Vater and Danacci, which is also work. It has its limitations, this work. Well, first, it has been published in German, but apart from that, it's just on Switzerland. but it's a cross-temporal comparison in Switzerland. And Vater shows in his work that those who are mainly impacted negatively by referendum outcomes are rather, foreign residents, religious minorities, anyway, those that are not, whatever the characteristics, those that are not considered to be part of the in-group. At the same time, it is mainly the expansion of their rights that is challenged or threatened by way of referendum, not the preservation of the rights. So you see, things are complicated, and I'm inclined to say that the assessment of the performance of referendum votes with regards to impartiality is quite complicated. You seem to be positive about the relationship between these votes and impartiality in your book. I'm a bit more skeptical. My second, and this is going to be my last comment, is perhaps a more fundamental one. Especially on controversial matters and on value-laden issues, there is no agreement about what good policy is and what the appropriate solutions to policy problems are. Let me perhaps illustrate this with the case of financial referendums. There's clear empirical evidence from Switzerland, from the United States, that they do have a restrictive influence on government spending. Is this good or bad? Well, as long as we have not agreed on the standards to apply, the problem will not be solved, and the observers will disagree depending on their political preferences. So my final question is about the evaluative standards that we use and that we apply on direct democracy mechanisms. So do you plead, Laurence, in favor of some sort of universals? Or do you acknowledge that standards are unavoidably, perhaps also necessarily, pluralist, possibly leading then to normative conflict? I don't know, for example, if there is a trade-off between participation and competent decision making. So how should one arbitrate between conflicting standards? You discuss in a very detailed and differentiated way, Laurence, different kinds of policy effects of referendums, but you take each of them individually. What about potential trade-offs between effects, and how should we deal with them? Well, those were my main questions, but let me stress.
Yanis, we've lost. I can hear you. I don't know if everybody can hear Yanis. Laurence?
Yes, I do.
Ah, yes, you can. I can't hear you, both of you. I don't know why.
I'm almost done. Well, but I left the most important for the end, so it's important to hear me. So that I would like to stress again how much this is an extremely thoughtful and important contribution to debate, not just on referendums, but also more generally on the quality of democracy. Thank you, Laurence.
Well, thank you, Yanis, because I think you are really very, very generous with me. I'm really honored. I must say, I didn't expect that. I was even a bit worried because I think you are very exigent. So I'm really very honored again. We could discuss 5 hours clearly. And we have 10 minutes or a bit more. I will try to answer your main question. So first, you say there is a sort of paradox, contradiction, I don't know how to call it, between the fact that there is a strong demand for more referendums. We're not talking about Switzerland because they have already a lot, but in other countries, for more referendum coming from the popular categories. But on the other side, we know that they don't participate. There is this as a social bias to participation. So the referendum maybe will not, doesn't make much sense, let's say, to increase the number of referendums if those who ask them will not participate. I don't know. First of all, I always tend to reason in terms of alternatives, you know. So what else? So if we don't increase direct democracy, if we agree that the problem is that there is a very an insufficient political participation of working classes, so what do we do? Apart from the referendum, I mean, of course, there might be exist other mechanisms to remotivate people, but I think the referendum is really has a good chance anyway to interest the people, provided they deal with issues, with topics the people care about. So here, there are a lot of conditions which can help, as according to me, to interest the people. And so I would not be that pessimistic, I would put it like that, that we're going to introduce these devices because marginalized people who are suffering, ask them, but then they won't take the opportunity. I'm not sure. I mean, this is, of course, a risk, but I think we don't have many alternatives. And this is, according to me, there is a lot of potential in direct democracy mechanism to mobilize the people. This is roughly what I would say. Regarding deliberation, yes, you mentioned there is this sort of, problem, I can't find the word, but people who study deliberative democracy know, the problem with deliberation is that the larger the public who deliberates, the lesser the quality of deliberation. So referendums, direct democracy mechanism are very criticized because of course, the pool, all citizens, would be too large to ensure correct deliberation. And of course, many publics I think this aspect is a bit exaggerated. I agree that you will never have such a nice deliberation with 30 million people. It's not like with 30 people. But on the other side, some deliberationists also say that the more people you have in deliberated, the more pluralism of argumentation you have. So at the end, it might be better, you know. The quality of deliberation is lower, but the food for deliberation is more rich. And this is a little bit the Aristotle argument, you know, that the more people you have, the more stuff you have. that's one thing. I don't like very much this obsession with pure deliberation. According to me, it's sort of ideal of, and this in vitro democracy, I call it like that, with mini public, you know, it's a bit exaggerating to me. I mean, the idea is good, of course. We have to make deliberation in the debates on the referendum better, but let's not be too perfectionist. I would be tempted to answer like that. I think the Oregon solution is very good. It's a good compromise also because it ends up with a referendum, because the problem now with many public theories is that they really suggest to get rid of the referendum at the end of the process. So they don't want decision be taken by elected people, nor by the people, just by sorted people. This is problematic. But the Oregon system is very good because it gives another supplementary argumentation to the citizens, which maybe is less biased. It's interesting that it is experimented now in Switzerland, because in Switzerland you are also a model, I think, well, not a perfect model, I guess, but the government indication when there is a referendum are quite well done, quite they try to be balanced. So you already have a sort of neutral, rather satisfactory presentation of the main argument of the debate. And now you want to do more, and it's good. You want to experiment the Oregon system while a sorted assembly of citizens will also present the main views. So I completely agree, because it ends up with a referendum. So with people, the whole people, the maxi public decision policies. I think policies, it's really difficult. I've tried to summarize a little bit the literature and make my own mind on this, but there are no really, no, we don't have quantitative reliable results about a so-called impact, an impact of the of popular vote on certain types of policies. What you said, maybe what is rather confirmed is the conservative effects, as you said. Maybe you, I don't know if you were speaking only about Switzerland, but citizens tend to negate, to refuse new rights, but not to to challenge existing rights to minorities. So it's a form of conservative. It's not, it's an example of conservatism, which is not reactionary, if I might say, because okay to keep existing rights, the problem is new rights. And this has not, not only minorities in Switzerland have been the victim of this, because the women have been the victim of this with the suffrage for years, but about so-called orientation of, well, what you're talking about is just what the problem is, maybe that the people do not think like their representatives, you know, so if the people tend to decide maybe in a more conservative way or intolerant way. So in a provocative way, I would be tempted to say, so what, in a way? No, because, well, of course, it's not as easy. But I mean, if you are for direct democracy, you are for people deciding, then, of course, you can have a lot of limits, inviolable rights and all the liberal limits. And I agree, there should be some limits. I'm not an extremist of direct democracy that would, in a populist way, to say it quickly, that would pretend there is no, everything can be decided through referendums. But with correct legal limits, I think it can be, let's say, okay. That's maybe, yes, good government. It's impossible to say, to check empirically that decisions are good. Then when do you check it? 1 month later, after, 3 months after, 10 years after the decision? You never know. So it's, I think most of the attempts to find a sort of policy effect of referendum are a bit bound to be inconclusive in a way. I'm a bit skeptical about this demonstrating anything, but I don't know exactly. Okay, maybe I think we should leave other people raise questions if they wish. So thank you very, very, very much again, Yanis, and I hope we can discuss this again.
There is another question from Dimitri. Are there analyses?
Hi, Dimitri.
Explaining, well, I hadn't seen it. Are there analyses explaining support for introducing or deepening direct democracy mechanisms among the politicians? An hypothesis would be that the outsiders are more prone to support changes, but I'm guessing other factors, orientation, generation, value, come into play.
Yes, of course. Well, I don't know if there are systematic analysis of the reason why some parties or politicians say they want to introduce more referendum opportunities. But the main, the main thesis is that it has very much to do with being in the opposition. being a small party, and first a small party, and even in government, that can be useful, but especially a small party in opposition. This is the most, as I was saying, in Switzerland and in Italy, well, in Italy, the Christian Democrats were not a minority party, but in Switzerland, there are small confessional parties, or also the socialist parties in the 19th century, which were also very small compared to the radical party. They clearly wanted to introduce a veto referendum in order to have a weapon to promote their own policies. So it is, but of course, there might be other explanation, like being responsive also to the citizens. In this period, many citizens say they would like to have more direct democracy mechanisms, so they might also, there can be a sort of responsiveness of parties or leaders to citizens in trying to promote or saying they would do this sort of institutional reform once they are elected.
Well, thanks a lot, Laurent. Yes, we have no more questions. Thanks again to both of you, and I hope to see all the participants we had today and on the next. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Bye.